Hello. Good morning, Sheila.
And fortunately, at least we have audio recordings. So I hope to be able to give you a little bit of a handle on how to figure out what somebody's doing by listening to an audio tape.
Could I ask briefly, what is your opinion and attitude to Tavish? I noticed you mentioned in the information that came to us that there will be no Tavish. Is that because you don't like it?
I'm not music literate. I have an attitude, perhaps a bad attitude, towards tablature. I feel that it can be helpful as a description of how to do something, but often it becomes the only way that people learn. So I try not to use it at all in teaching, because I want people to hone their ears. And I can show you what I'm doing as many times as you want within reason. During the class, so that you can actually see it,
yeah.
And we can talk it onto a tape if you need to. The important thing to do, and I'll say this over and over again, is to listen to the music that you want to make for a lot, because it's the hearing of it is how you get your real education. And that's true of classical musicians as well. If they're going to make classical music, they're going to listen to their music a heck of a lot. And the notes will guide them. People who read from notes tend to be very goal-oriented. They're going to hit that note. And in this kind of music, you're not supposed to be that. You're supposed to be more of a process-oriented musician. And, I mean, really some of the best classical musicians are process-oriented, really. And they have, of course, learned their music by ear. So I'm going to encourage you to listen to these tapes. If anybody, well, if you could bring your dubbing deck, that would be a great help for people. There also is an AV department here, which I think can dub tapes. If somebody wants just to take my master tapes and arrange to do that, that'd be great. I have the contents here too, so you can Xerox those easily.
I would trust that more than I would the dubbing deck that I brought, which is not that good.
Okay.
Who's this recorder at?
Jerry,
yeah.
Is the AV center open, and can they dub tapes, cassette tapes?
I'll check in.
Okay. Should we check in with somebody else downstairs, because you're probably pretty busy? Okay. Thanks. In the past, that's what we've done. I have a problem with this in that I don't have a dubbing deck, and it would take me a long time to get my two or three home decks to dub off the tapes. And it did occur to me too late.
But there's supposed to be someone here who brought some equipment and is willing to either record you or do some of that, but I'm not sure what you think. Jerry will.
Okay. Well, Jerry will look into that, he said. So between that and the Xerox machine, I think we can get this done. I don't know how many of you would like to dub the tape.
I would.
Okay. So really we need 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 copies of the tape. I can play you some of the stuff myself. What I thought I'd do is to just talk for a little while, play a few tunes very briefly, just so you hear some of the different sounds, and then I'd like to come out of here with at least one. For instance, with us able to play maybe some Charlie Poole backup this morning, I'm sure we can do that. Before we go any further, I want to do something that I want to take down. Bring a pencil. Maybe I can borrow one from somebody. I'd like to just quickly go around the group and know anything, have you tell us anything that you would like to particularly focus in on. So if we could do that. Can we start with you, Clara?
Sure.
I
fair amount of tuning here, so don't wait.
As you all know, the banjo came from Africa with slaves in the 16, 17, 1800s. Mostly 16, 1700, I believe, although our knowledge of banjo history seems to be changing a lot as some people do more and more research with the very few written reports there are of banjo from the 18th century especially. We used to think that it was the mid-1800s when white people started picking the banjo. Now we know it could be easily the late 1700s when white people started picking the banjo a little bit. Excuse me. But there's no doubt that black people played the banjo and it was very much identified with being black and with slave lore by the late 18th century. In my own mind, I just, having been in Africa just briefly and seeing the variety of musical instruments that they had there and just kind of feeling what it was like, I feel that as soon as black people hit this place, they started playing the fiddle, I think. And they were being paid as slaves, they were being forced to play the fiddle in a variety of styles for their masters fairly early on. And it only makes sense to me that then the banjo had to mix, you know, because, I mean, they could have been playing banjo and fiddle in the 1600s. Could have been, I'm not saying they did. But this kind of stuff wasn't written about, say, back then, hardly. Some travelers would write, but I guess most of the people down there didn't think about it that much, or they certainly didn't write about it.
What kind of music would they have played on the fiddle?
Well, as slaves, they would play their master's music. And then, to me, God only knows, relatives of Cripple Creek or Ida Red, or all kinds of wild fiddle tunes. I've recorded a black fiddle player in Maryland. He was born about 1890. He had quite a different repertoire and a way of playing than any black white person, or black person for that matter, that I've recorded or heard of. If you go back and read some of the slave narratives that were collected in the 1900s, or some of the few collections that there were of black music, you can only imagine what was played by the outline of the tune that's in some of the books and the lyrics. And then, of course, there are these minstrel songs, which were probably, everybody believes, they're based on black music. They are definitely more structured than what you get out of slave narratives. So we don't really know. I have a feeling in my head what some of the things could be like, but there's only a feeling. The things like Bessie Jones would do, and little pieces of songs that you hear from Georgia Buck. I play a little Georgia Buck on the banjo. This is from Libba Cott. And
she was. Can you tell us the tuning?
Sure. This is just going to be straight G tuning. But it's probably tuned a whole tone low, I expect. Some rhythmic music with a fairly simple tune that leaves lots of room for playing with little parts of it. The tune is basically has only one part, but Libba played four parts to it, depending on what you consider a part or a variation. Banjo, this is a copy of several banjos that Clark Buehling made. That is, it's a copy from paintings. And Clark and I worked out this way of having the skin attached rather than using the tacks, because I wanted something that didn't have any metal in it and would be slightly adjustable. You can tighten this here with the wedges. No frets, gut strings, not nylon.
up, it gives a much better tone, although they don't last very well. You can see the fraying where I use my nail a lot. It's a basket gourd, and it's calf skin head, although it could be cat skin or anything at first, maybe that's what you have, or groundhog or whatever. And what they used for strings back then, I have no idea. Some people said silk sometimes. Gut would have probably required some money, because I mean, it takes a lot to make a gut string. Although I saw an advertisement in Lexington, Virginia, in a department store of the time for gut strings for a banjo in 1855. So white folks were definitely, you know, playing the banjo by then. And in any case, by the mid-1800s, banjo was reaching a lot of white people, and they were starting to make them with wooden hoops for a variety of reasons. You could get more volume, they were more dependable. They began putting frets in the late 1800s, and the far late 1800s, steel strings. And then they began making these metal banjos about the same time, heavily metallized banjos in the late, more like this, is that a Wyman?
Yes.
Yeah, the, like this here would be from the late 1800s. And quite ornate, because white people were using them in parlors then. And they were trying to elevate the banjo into polite behavior, as opposed to those bizarre Africans. And then, of course, eventually the tone ring type of banjo here, the tubophone in the early 1900s, and eventually the master tone, which is the one that is used in bluegrass music with a resonator on the back, is the ultimate banjo, and they haven't really essentially changed that since 1926 or 7. That's the ultimate bluegrass banjo with just tiny refinements since then. And now some folks like myself are progressing backwards. This is Clark Buehling from Arkansas, and Bob Flesher is beginning to make some gourd banjos, make some nice mid-1800s type banjos too. Okay, tune I learned from Libba Cotton. She's a black woman from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, born about 1895, and learned to play in a strictly traditional setting there from her brothers, probably mostly, and her family. I'm sure there were a few musicians around, older musicians. She played in this style. It's pick, then strum. She played left-handed using this as the drum string. So you see, I'm already changing it. She only used that fifth string once in a very, very great while. So I'm already not sounding like Libba Cotton. Plus, I'm not going to play the same style, which is the, but I'm going to knock. You can hear the difference, I'm sure. Hard to hear sometimes on a recording, but you can often hear whether it's a knocked note or a picked note.
By knock, you mean just downstroke?
Yes. I'm using the terms quite often, knocking, rapping, frailing, interchangeably.
Okay.
It's semi-conscious at this point. And picking, but picking is always up. When I say pick, I mean up. Except when I say banjo picking is a general term. So it's basically a rapping style, and I'm going to pick off on this string here. Fair amount, probably. You want to come around to the front? I think it might be easier.
The name of the tune again?
The tune?
Yes.
Georgie Buck. Not Georgia Buck, usually.
Yorkies did. Last word he said, didn't want no shortening in his bread. Shortening in his bread, swimming in his head.
Anything like Liber Cottonet is.
Oh.
It has no resemblance except the basic tune is there. And she did put in about four changes and then the change up to the four chord came from a white guy over in Virginia somewhere. So it really, it's a collection of different parts to Georgia Buck. But the basic idea was knocking down with my first finger. Every now and then I caught myself using this on to strike the string on the offbeat. So it was, in a way, two finger knocking. Which is one of the ways of getting the knocking style. And because some of those Mount Airy folks do that, where they get a cluck by going with their second finger and then letting their first the fingernail fall against the string to give it a little bit of an offbeat. It's like a rock and roll backbeat kind of feeling, you know. And I think Riccio does that, I think a fair amount, doesn't he? On the Red Hots tape. A lot of flavors. Okay, there's two or three other ways of getting that same style. One was I already showed you what Liber Cottonet does. That does is gives you lots of extra speed. And there are certain things you can't do in each of these styles. Doesn't sound right.
Does that fine tuner work for you?
It's very, very fine.
You don't get any weird overtones from it?
No, unless it falls against a string. It doesn't give you a whole lot. But when you have the old-timey type here, it can be helpful.
What kind of bridge is that?
The guy who made this banjo, Richard Newman, is a furniture sculptor. He makes custom furniture. And he loved the banjo, and so he made a very few banjos. And this is hollow in here. It's a copy of a turn-of-the-century banjo. And it gives a lot of wood to it. And he made that bridge to go with the banjo. And I love that bridge. It's been on there about 12, 15 years now. It's very fragile, as you can see. It's very thin. And then it scoops out. It doesn't even have a wedge shape. It scoops out. He's really into aesthetics, you know. Even tiny little things like putting this curve in here, in that where the fifth string is. He's into the finer details. And since he was such a fine, fancy sculptor, we decided to leave the neck absolutely plain.
Could I just
out of perversity.
Just ask a question of a very fundamental nature, because you were doing something just now with the gourd banjo, which I think you call clucking.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah, I realized as you did it that I couldn't do that because the way I've taught myself claw hammers is picking with my first finger. Am I doing it wrong?
No. The traditional players, almost without, with a couple of exceptions, knock with their first finger. And then there's a few who knock with their first finger, then have the offbeat with their second. Ralph Stanley is one of those, for instance. So it's like this. You just pull your first finger out of the way and hit with your second finger. And then there are some, I've seen some who knock with their first finger and rap with all three. Oh, as a matter of fact, I'll do something for you that way just to show you. This is a tuning E, C, G, C, C. Many C's. E, C, G, C, C. Actually, on the offbeat, he might even be using all three to kind of deaden the strings. They almost come to rest. You know, just trying to give you another idea of the... That's the absolute opposite end of rapping from what I was doing there. I was playing single strings on both beats there, like this. That banjo. Here, I was playing one string, or sometimes two, and then brushing across all the strings on the offbeat. And Grandpa Jones, when he frails, he doesn't even hit one string usually on the down, the first downbeat. He'll often hit two. They're very different.
Have we done strictly with the first two strings tuned in unison?
No. That style would be done with a number of tunings. This is a pretty unusual tuning. In fact, I've only heard it on that one song by one person.
The fifth string is E, you said?
Yeah, uh-huh. What I was doing here was to show you another way of getting that frailing sound, but without frailing. And why it has a characteristic sound. Actually, this is close to, I think, the way I believe that Morgan Sexton plays with this this motion, but he makes it sound entirely different by just being moving his fingers in a certain way, but I think he uses this motion. Sounds quite a bit different then. I think it sound different.
Yeah, sure. And that's an uptick.
The last time I did it, I knocked it.
Yeah,
I frailed it.
The time.
But this time. Now, sometimes you'll hear somebody like Ralph Stanley who can go from one style to the other and it sounds almost exactly the same. Ralph, I've heard him play. Oh, wait a minute, he may have had a finger pick on. I've heard him do four different styles of Little Birdie without stopping, and you couldn't hardly tell the difference. He had also this way of playing that, just to give you an idea of how different it sounds.
I better ask, what's the point of four different styles at least?
Because you get different sounds. There are different things that you can do with these two styles.
Before you change tunings, I'm sorry, could you do what you did with that Morgan Sexton slower, or talk about what you're doing?
I thought we would do that later.
Okay.
We will go into that.
Is that standard banjo tuning that you're in now, isn't it?
It's
not double C.
It's just
C-tuning.
One C note down here. I can show you that. Yeah. Melody with the first finger on any of these four strings, and then brush with the second finger, and then snag the fifth string.
So your melody is an up stroke.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And your brush is a down.
Mm-hmm. I call that up down picking, but you know.
Well, you can assure us once and for all that your brother Pete didn't invent that sign.
Oh, yes.
A lot of clawhammer people that aren't knowledgeable think that that's not a traditional style, the up picking, but it is.
It's widely used, yeah. And Libba Cotton didn't learn it from my brother Pete. and nor did Ralph Stanley, or Morgan Sexton, or Roscoe Holcomb, I think, used that style. I'm not sure whether Roscoe used this style or this style. And it's picking up and brushing down with the same finger. That has a distinct sound too, to me at least. I'll play you one tune in that tune.
But the rhythms of all those are at least similar with different flavors.
There's a slightly different lope to it because of the way the mechanics of the fingers, you know.
It would be helpful for me when you change tunings if you either say them or play the strings individually so when I listen to it later.
Okay. And if I don't, remind me.
Okay.
Yeah. That was in dropped, what I call dropped bass C, just one note down. The fourth string was tuned down to C.
That's the old classical banjo tuning.
Yes, I call it that too, and I didn't know whether that was common or not. You know, call it classical.
Some West Virginians, Frank George, just call it low bass.
Uh huh.
Would you?
Well, that's why I'm torn between these different terms that I've heard.
They got it.
I think a banjo pitch pipe is in that tuning, isn't it? If you buy a pitch pipe.
Oh, no kidding. this is in a weird C tuning, which is string up to A.
One of my students asked me why I gave him a screwdriver on his first lesson. I told him to be patient. Told him he has a good career, is that right?
That's a carpenter.
Probably. If they have a good banjo, they wouldn't be needing to ask. But lots of banjos you'd be needing to ask halfway through. This is just a little piece of a tune to try to give you an idea of what you can do, why you want to have this kind of motion with one for a finger. And the tuning is A, C, G, C, E. It's basically an open C tuning, except that the fifth string is up to the sixth note of the scale in A.
And the name of the tune?
And French Waltz. It's not French, and it's not a waltz. From Clyde Troxell. You use the fifth string to play part of the tune. fret the fifth string. That is partly because now I could play that with the Pete Seeger style and it'd sound pretty much the same. If I were to frail that, it just doesn't cut it, you know. So that's then you have the Bascom-Lunsford style, which wouldn't cut it there either. On that tune. I'll show you a little bit of that. And then we'll go on to something. Call this detuning, although it's in C, because it has the two C's, and then the rest of it's the classical banjo tuning. So it's a G, C, G, C, D, more or less.
More like double C.
Yes, some people would call that double C, right. Now, in this style, you're picking up both the on-beat, or melody note, and the off-beat.
Name of the tune?
Pardon?
The name of the tune?
Let's do Mole on the Ground. And there'll be a slight backbeat sometimes, too. Sure.
One that you were using to start.
On the Bascom-Lamar style,
yeah, yeah.
It's actually Western North Carolina, amongst other places. I've seen a guy who's a real good Scruggs player from Missouri playing this style, too, so it's not just one area. But the idea is to pick up on the first note of a four-beat measure, and then have the second beat silent, and then on the off-beat you pick up with your first finger across a couple strings, and then snag the fifth string on the fourth beat. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. And sometimes you'll go.
Thank you. So that second beat was filled in with a down pick or a down brush.
Well, then you still did the rest of it as before. In other words, you have the downbeat, but in up motion. And then on the two,
you're down.
And then, as you did before, you're picking up on the third beat of the measure. And then snag the fifth string on the fourth. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Can you just do that a few times over and over? Just to see.
Sure. We can go into this more deeply. I'm just trying to give you a survey of what there is and why they're different, and have you then, we'll be able to pick up, go more in detail on some of these later. G tuning. Tune called Whoop the Devil Round the Stump. East Tennessee, Western North Carolina tune, and G tune. And I was using the back. Okay, the thumb lead, which we'll go into tomorrow, is basically playing the melody on the second, third, or fourth strings, and using the outer strings, the fifth and the first, as off beats, as drones.
Two fingers down, or finger down, yeah.
Yeah. So fair and stout, I hope he'll marry a factory girl before this year goes out. Pity me all day, pity me I pray, pity me my darling and take me far away. George Pegram basically played that style, and it's great for backing up people rhythmically. It goes good with Cajun music, too, because you can get rowdy with it, too. Well, actually, that's closer to George Pegram than Roscoe Hawkins Poe.
What was the name of the tune?
Factory Girl. I haven't thought of it for years, but somehow it came up this morning. I'd like to do well, somebody already asked for that. We'll do a song in that tomorrow, in that tune, at least one. And then we go into the finger-picking styles, and I'm not going to do Charlie Poole right now, because we'll actually do that after this. And I'll do a little bit of Doc Boggs just to show you how. Basically, Doc Boggs and Charlie Poole are quite similar in that the right hand is nothing but classical, almost like classical guitar. I'm going to get more or less in tune here. sloppy about tuning, I've been told. What is this that I... Oh, yes, the tuning.
Yeah. Sorry.
Ed Sharp, and he used either a C or a D on the bass, depending on the requirements of the tune. On Pretty Polly, for instance, it would have been D. But on Oak Death or Country Blues, it's a C on the bass. G, A, D. And he's basically just playing the melody on the third, on the third and fourth strings, and then occasionally, as I'll show you later, he plays the melody on the second and first. What is this that I can see with icy hands taking hold on me? I am death in none case, till I'll open the doors to hell nor hell. Oh, death, oh, death, please spare me over till another year. Oh, death, oh, death, please spare me over till another year. Technically style. It's technically very simple, but if you want to learn it, I found it's difficult to teach. I can get you most of the way through it, but there's a couple of funny little things that go on that I find very difficult to do anything but show you how to do a few times. Or I'll show you forever, but it's very, very difficult to figure out just what it is. If you want to, we can do it, but we'd probably end up taking a whole day session on it. Then we could go into some of the finger-picking styles, but I won't do that because I think what I've been trying to show you is some of the older styles here and what the differences are between them and why you use one style rather than another. Some people say, why do you use different tunings? I hope that that's more or less clear so far. There are certain drones and certain effects that you can get that you want, either for the singing or the playing, that you can only get if you tune the banjo to one of these some 50-some tunings. David's, he's doing it. He's a great banjo player, by the way, David Winston. There's no better than him, just different. He's great rhythm and melody. Why don't we play some music here? How about it? Let's tune up into a... let's do the Charlie Poole clavis tuning, which is a low bass or classical tuning. And he had a banjo, well, it was an Orpheum most of the time, from what I heard. Well, it's not quite like this. It had a wooden hoop with a very thin metal rim around the top of it.
Orpheum number two?
I don't know what number.
I have one of those.
And he was into the parlor banjo, I guess you'd say, and early kind of turn-of-the-century popular style banjo. And they mixed it with a very smooth fiddle and a country version of parlor guitar. And basically, since Charlie was the singer, he didn't want to have to do anything complicated on the banjo while he was singing, so it ended up just being parlor guitar, almost. In key of, say, in the key of G, he would bar a chord up here. I had planned to play you a recording of Charlie Poole, but we can't do that right now. So you bar at least the two bass notes, the third and fourth strings, and then make a C chord with your other, with any of your two other fingers that you prefer. Okay, and then you play a bass note, and then the first two strings with your first two fingers on the offbeat. third and fourth string. I go up fourth and third string. So it'll sound like this. Listen to me do it once. And that's all there is to it. Let's do it a little slower than that. I took classical guitar for about 3 months, and the main thing I learned from that was to pick perpendicularly against the strings, not like this, but more like this. So I want to make sure that some of you all get at least that principle. And you want to play more or less here. Let's all get on the same beat here together. Just fall in behind me. Is your banjo totally inoperable? Does anybody have an extra banjo?
I have a fretless.
Yeah.
I can get one or
no. You can use this one and I'll use that one. The best
you'll need to retune it. It's a different tuning.
Funky thing here.
I built it in Bob's class last year.
Oh, it's really nice.
Thank you.
Okay. For my own convenience, can we do this down in C here for right now? When we're working on the right hand.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, there's a couple of other things that Charlie would do. Go like this. And then, of course, run. And you just and then you can. Some of these are not strictly exactly what Charlie would do either, by the way. That one he did do. And another one he would do. Singing. He just basically used this to give a little bit of plunk behind the guitar, which was really doing some complex work. It was, as far as I know, he was playing with a thumb and three fingers and doing wild rolls. You know. I mean, all kinds of things that the guitar player was doing. Charlie was singing and just playing a little bit. Sometimes at the end of a line. Tell me how long have I got to wait? Can I get you now? cause to hesitate. Like that. I mean, it's very, very simple. And the guitar was doing the work, and the fiddle was, of course, doing all the melody work. Mm-hmm. Now, you can add things to that style, and I do, because I played with a bluegrass band before I really tried to play much like Charlie Poole. And so I've added one or two things. Did you have? What we really do need is a boom box to play tapes on. And Jerry thought that he could look into that. Oh, no, that wasn't true.
He was checking into the dubbing.
And he was going to check into the dubbing situation, because we need to dub a dozen copies of a tape that I brought and Xerox the contents, the track sheet. And I assumed that the AV Center could do that. They have in the past.
But you also need a boombox.
We need a boombox to play our tapes.
Mike, if nothing else works.
Right here.
Yes.
Okay, is there anyone here who has one?
Yeah, I think I can get one over here.
Just as a backup, just
okay.
In case we can.
Yeah, I just remember the guy I traveled with has got one in his trunk.
Do you think he'd be willing to let us use it?
I've got one. Did he play all the different chords by barring that?
Yes. There are other roles, just like the ones that you're doing there. That's a guitar, basically a guitar role.
Well, isn't that what you just showed us?
Not quite.
No. Oh, I'm doing... He was doing this, and I was doing...
No, you're going... I was going...
Oh, all right, I'm sorry. Yeah.
It's okay, but I want you to be,
right, to be like...
conscious of the...
Right.
That's a different guitar lick. Now some other people would go like this. They would do a Carter Family, a Maybelle Carter kind of thing. You can do that as well. Sometimes it's fun to mix that in. Another thing you can do is also to use this chord position occasionally when you're up. This is an Earl Scruggs bluegrass chord position. It's an F from down here, but you can also move all over the place. Be careful of your bass note, though. In this key, it happens to be right.
When you were doing the Carter thing, was that was just a strum?
Let me show you the Carter Family lick that I was doing. You'll occasionally have a use for that. You play a bass note with your thumb, and then on the off beat, on the third beat of a four beat measure, you go. Why doesn't everybody try that? Thumb on the downbeat, finger upwards on the second beat, downwards on the third beat, and upwards on the fourth beat. So it sounds like this. Finger on the third, and then back up with your finger on the fourth, like this. we go back to the Charlie Poole, the original Charlie Poole lick that I was getting you to do, I just want to check everybody a little bit more close up than I did before, okay? In other words, this lick. Let's do it down in the open chord here. It's a little easier on your hand. almost got it, but... Just up to you. I tend to be in the middle region for Charlie Poole, around here. So it's not extreme in either direction.
You don't tend to play that style up on the neck at all.
Up here?
Sometimes a lot of people like to play.
I don't, and I don't know exactly why. It's a matter of I've just settled into a certain place.
There was a C position up the neck you did a few minutes ago while I was fixing my bridge. Would you mind showing that again?
This position, which down here, and then your bass and your bass first position or whatever you want to call it, is an F. Can everybody see that? It's this sound. A lot of bluegrass players use that as a movable position all over the neck, as Charlie Poole used his C. If you move it up here to C, here's the principle: F, G, A, B, and then of course B to C is a half note. Your first finger, everybody's got it. Happens to be very nice that you've got a bass note up here. Now, there are other right-hand rolls that you can do, but before we do that, I'd like to listen to Charlie Poole's. I'd like to listen to Charlie Poole doing this.
Thank you.
gonna take them out to your family now. I got to you, me. For the pain I can feel now. Like a hand I take.
Different role going there. There's more to his role. He's doing it in D, although it's D sharp here. Let's not do that. Let's take it like C though, because it's much easier. And I believe he must have a capo on or be tuned up, quite possibly tuned up to D. A lot of banjo pickers would tune the whole banjo up to here. And he's going to the F chord. I don't think he's going up. I don't think he is. Don't you think?
I think he's staying in the first position.
I think he is, yes. So I believe he's hitting this F chord here, or it would be a G chord for him, of course. They are playing in D. I'm not sure what role he's going. I can't tell. We don't have a whole lot of treble on
him. Yeah, it doesn't sound like it.
And so it's very hard to pick out what the banjo is really doing. It sounds like he's doing much more of a role than I was showing you. But it's hard to separate it from the guitar, because the guitar is definitely doing something like that for his F chord, for his G chord. And then he's going to, I believe he's doing this for his five chord. Back to the C. By the way, so that I was using this modern terminology for the chords. When a lot of folks play these days, when you only have a few chords, actually when you have more than a few chords, they'll call the chord that you're playing in the basic tonic chord. Say you're in C, that would be one. And then if you play an F chord, that would be C, D, E, F. They call that a four chord. And then the G chord would be, of course, the five chord. So I may be using these terms here for you. It's a fairly simple way of saying what chord to go to next, no matter what key you're in. So you'd go like this. If the river was whiskey and I was a duck, dive to the bottom and I never come up, but tell me how long I ever got to wait. Oh, can I get you now? Or must I hesitate? He didn't do that. That was Doc Walsh. Should we do that? And he was just going strictly the alternating route that I was going like this. He was definitely going according to the chords and the tune. And at the end of lines, he would go. Or, I don't think. think I heard any other runs going through that.
I thought I heard the descending run.
I feel like what he was doing in one place was something like that, but you see, I can't tell from the guitar exactly. I don't know. So what I've done is I've found a few other roles that you can put in, and I've learned them from people like Doc Walsh, and there's kind of adaptations. Do that one if you like. Just a couple of other roles that you can put in if you get tired of the other one. it's a bass note and then two arpeggios from the third, second to first string. Now listen to me do it a couple times. Difficult because after the in the silent place that we had after the bass note, you can either hit the first or the second string like this. Or the second string. Do it a little bit slower than that because that's a little more difficult. Let's try the first string. In other words, the outside strings and then two arpeggios. This is an arpeggio. Okay, let's try it this way. Listen to me do it a couple times, then fall in with me.
And you will find other roles. These are just a few of the roles that people use, and they sprinkle them all around, you know, according to how, just how, what fits the tune. There's some really weird roles, like Lena Hughes had some weird things that I can't even remember. Something weird like that. And I'd like to encourage you to mess around with some of that stuff and find just things that sound nice and odd, you know, but that still will back up a song or something like that. Doc Walsh in the 20s would sometimes just record a song. Accordin' in the rain, accordin' in the rain. I never knew what accordin' was till accorded in the rain. That's another one I haven't shown you yet. That can be a lot of fun. It's very much like two finger picking. In fact, you can do the same thing with two fingers as with three. I'd like to have you do it with three fingers for right now, though. Okay? Let me see if I can break it down for you, because that's a very, very handy rhythmic backup lick. Actually, it's almost the same as this one. Let's do it with two fingers. I think maybe we should. It'd be easier. Let me stop and try to figure out what I'm doing. Thumb, second with your first finger, fifth string, and then first string with your first finger. Let me see if that is what I'm doing. And then third finger on the third string. Now let me see. Are we doing it right? No. Then it's the third string with your thumb, and then second string with your finger, thumb string, and then first string with your first finger. And I'll see if that makes sense. It, but that's hard to follow, isn't it? Let me see if there's a pattern to this that's easily conceptualized. Similar to this. But you're alternating your thumb between that third and fourth string all the time. And you're alternating also between the second and the first string with your first finger. Okay, let me show you what you're doing here. See, now you're doing that already, right? Okay, now just put a fifth string between every one of those third and fourth strings and alternate between the second and first strings, you see. Let me start it off for you, and maybe you can get the hang of it. But conceptually, that's the idea. Listen to me, everybody. Listen to me. Do it once. You got it. But let me listen to it. I mean, let me figure it out, and you listen to it. little bit slower than that and see how we can do it. I'm finding it very difficult to slow it down myself. Real slow. Same string twice with the same finger. In other words, you don't want to go, well, you can actually, it sounds fine. You can do that. But basically what I'm trying to get you to do is to... In other words, not to always... You're treating these two as two separate... departments that you don't want to repeat on either string twice. I'm having a hard time articulating that. You all have it. And I think you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Just let me just continue my rounds here.
Sorry, I didn't
put it more clearly. Your first finger should alternate between the first and second strings. Not play it twice in a row. Your thumb should alternate between the third and fourth strings and not repeat either the third or fourth string. And your thumb wants to alternate between the third and the fifth, or the fourth and the fifth, like this. And your first finger will alternate between the first and second. And so it should again sound like this. And you can, it's fine to use two fingers if you prefer. You get a slightly different rhythm if you use these. slightly different, just very slightly. And some people lay heavy on the fifth string to give you a heavy backbeat. And some people will just, like George Pegram, he puts a thumb pick on, or he put a thumb pick on the first finger, and he goes. It's incredibly rhythmic behind a harmonica or a band. It's more rhythmic than anything. Okay, I think we've just about exhausted that particular.
My tape player, maybe others.
B, low bass, C. Tuning. And the basic Charlie Poole, the most basic Charlie Poole is. And that's picking with two fingers up on the first and second string and using the thumb on the third and fourth strings. And then a suggestion of an arpeggio. Okay, and then thumb, first finger, second finger. Or, and that's the second finger on the first string. Or the second finger, first finger on the second string. More of a feeling of the chord that you're in that way, because you're hitting an octave there. Is that slow enough? And then we were working on something which can either be done with two fingers or three. Do a three-finger roll with just two fingers. I don't know why they want to do it, but they did. And that's just two fingers. That's a thumb and one finger. And you can do that if you want to. I don't see why it's necessary, but they did it that way. A lot of them. Certain roles that you can do that way. You have to go have ones that go the right direction. There's certain roles you just can't get that way. By roles, I mean a succession of strings that you're hitting with.
Are you dragging the string across two fingers to do that?
I'm kind of dragging my finger a little bit. Doc Watson insists that you're picking that when you're doing that. You're dodging your finger in a little bit to catch that second string. That's more of an academic thing in a way to me, because I'd rather do that with two fingers and not work quite so hard. But Merle Travis picked the guitar with a thumb and a finger and did amazing things that way. Let's see, we have about a half hour left. That's only the first And it's a good one for working this, just to get this one down, this pattern down. I'll play it for you a couple times. And you can either go to the full C chord or not the full C chord. I'll not go to the full C chord this time. First part of the tune. Get the first part of that tune down today here. Now what I'd like to do is do it for you slow once through. Well, I bet you all can just do it following me. Let's do the first part of the tune. Let's see. This much. Let's do that much together. Fall in with me now. One and a two and a three and go. Actually, it's such an easy tune, you can almost do it all the way through anyway.
Yeah, right.
So follow me all the way through on the tune. I'll play it to you for you once real slow. This note, and you don't always need that first note that first string on the C chord. And on your, when you're playing this note, it's sometimes real nice not to be playing that seventh. Just play the note that you want, the A, second fret, third string. So that you're, you can actually, it's a one of those one finger tunes. Things will come out over the course of the week here. The banjo from the period of the gourd was not a chord instrument. Chords came in with frets, and the original idea of the banjo was somewhere between, it was melodic percussion with drone, you see. And the idea of chords is really a fairly new one, and I'd like to encourage you to think of tunes and drones first, and chords last, really. I like for you to think of tunes, chords, and rhythm, you know, especially rhythm. Some folks forget that the banjo is a rhythm, at least in old time music, is a rhythm instrument. In bluegrass, it's not so much of a rhythm instrument, because the bass and the guitar, and to some extent the mandolin, chop, is the rhythm, and so the banjo was set free into a different department with Earl Scruggs and, well, Snuffy Jenkins and Earl Scruggs.
Just want to think that there's a little lick you do at the end when you.
Make friends, and I have so far everywhere I went, and I love everybody, and I'm just tickled to go and try to play and do what I can to help out a little.
Thank you. Phoebe, your ancestors, your maiden name was Cottrell.
Huh?
Your maiden name was Cottrell.
Yeah.
So your ancestors, I know for a fact, were some of the very first people to settle in Calhoun County.
No.
Yeah, some of
them. Well, yeah. Oh, I thought I misunderstood you. I can hear very good.
Yeah. And I was wondering, I know the Cottrells were all a lot of fiddle players.
Yes, they was.
I was wondering, when did they take up the banjo? I mean, was that, where did your father play the fiddle and the banjo?
No, he just played the fiddle and danced now. And my mother danced and sung. She was a whitlatch and a lady. My mother was. She was put out amongst people when she was born. Her mother died. And her parents, her grandparents kept her till she got 6 years old, and then they had to break up house keeping, and she was put out from first one place and another, you know. And she was married twice, and she had to put her young'uns out amongst strangers. She married my dad, you know, and they was all grown up at that time.
So your dad just played the fiddle, he didn't play the banjo?
No, he didn't play the banjo, but he played the fiddlesticks.
Huh.
He played the fiddlesticks, he danced, and he played the fiddle. And that's and he couldn't sing very good, but now my mother could. She is a good singer. And my half-brother, George, his name is George, he could sing.
Hello, good morning, Sheila.
And fortunately, at least we have audio recordings, so I hope to be able to give you a little bit of a handle on how to figure out what somebody's doing by listening to an audio tape.
Can I ask briefly, what is your opinion and attitude to Tavish? I noticed you mentioned in the information that came to us that there will be no Tavish. Is that because you don't like it?
I'm not music literate. I have an attitude, perhaps a bad attitude, towards tablature. I feel that it can be helpful as a description of how to do something.
but often it becomes the only way that people learn. And so I try not to use it at all in teaching, because I want people to hone their ears. And I can show you what I'm doing as many times as you want, within reason, during the class, so that you can actually see it.
Yeah.
And we can talk it onto a tape if you need to. The important thing to do, and I'll say this over and over again, is to listen to the music that you want to make for a lot, because it's the hearing of it is how you get your real education. And that's true of classical musicians as well. If they're going to make classical music, they're going to listen to their music a heck of a lot. And the notes will guide them. People who read from notes tend to be very goal-oriented. They're going to hit that note. And in this kind of music, you're not supposed to be that. You're supposed to be more of a process-oriented musician. And, I mean, really some of the best classical musicians are process-oriented, really. And they have, of course, learned their music by ear. So I'm going to encourage you to listen to these tapes. If anybody, well, if you could bring your dubbing deck, that would be a great help for people. There also is an AV department here, which I think can dub tapes. If somebody wants just to take my master tapes and arrange to do that, that'd be great. I have the contents here too, so you can Xerox those easily.
I would trust that more than I would the dubbing deck that I brought, which is not that good.
Okay.
It was just a recorder app.
Jerry,
yeah.
Is the AV center open, and can they dub tapes, cassette tapes?
I'll check in.
Okay. Should we check in with somebody else downstairs, because you're probably pretty busy? Okay. Thanks.
Fred stepped up. The judge looked down there and said, Mr. Gerald, just how much liquor you think you've hauled through the city of Abington, Virginia this year? And Fred said, he looked up and said, well, Your Honor, to tell you the truth, probably ran 10,000 gallons. And the judge looked down at him and said, that'll be a $5 fine, and don't never let me see you here again. But that's Tommy's brother, Fred, and Early was just as ornery. They were great people. I enjoyed them so much. I'll do a Tommy Gerald piece here that I don't know where this song came from originally, but Tommy used to sing it a lot because he liked moonshiner songs.